Hello everyone, welcome to Litspedia learning series. Today in this video lecture, I would like to give you the important aspects concerning the old English epic poem Beowulf from a UGC net point of view. And together with this, in this lecture itself, we will also discuss the non-details regarding the two important old English writers who were Caedmon and Cynewulf. And this video will also be useful for aspirants appearing for competitive examinations related to English literature. And members who watch this video, I have a suggestion. If you have any subject area to suggest for me to take lecture, kindly give your suggestions in the comment section below. So let's move on to our subject area now. So we are starting with Beowulf. So, considering Beowulf, it is actually England's oldest extant national epic and is made probably in the 7th century AD. This is what we need to understand about the basic details of Beowulf. And it is also a Scandinavian story of the Geatish hero Beowulf. And it also contains 3182 lines. So, regarding Beowulf, I have given a little bit mentioning in the previous audio video lecture. And I am actually dividing this Beowulf analysis into three sections. So first we will discuss the plot of Beowulf, then we will come to the features and analysis, and then we will discuss regarding the contemporary significance. So we need to understand that while approaching a literary work, actually even if it is for an university examination or if it is for a competitive examinations, we need to understand that rather than just understanding the summary or the plot line of the story, we need to know the literary elements used in that, the allegorical elements, so indirect references regarding that, all these things we need to understand while approaching a literary work. So we are starting with the basic Old English work itself, Beowulf. So here I am dividing into three sections, plot, then we will discuss features and analysis, and then we will go to the contemporary significance, that means in the modern world, after that how these writers come to see this literary work. So let's start with the plot. So, regarding plot, I would like to divide it into two sections. Two sections we can see. In the first part of Beowulf, the Geatish warrior Beowulf kills a monster called Grendel. I have mentioned it before. And Grendel is a monster. He attacks Heorot. Heorot is actually the hall of the Danish king Hrothgar, whom with Beowulf and their land it is, Danish land. And actually the monster was killed by Beowulf during the fight. And later we can see the monster's name is Grendel, and this Grendel's mother come to seek revenge for Beowulf because he killed the monster Grendel. And after that we can see Beowulf successfully kills Grendel's mother too. So that is regarding the first part of Beowulf. And in the second part we can see the second part of Beowulf is set 50 years later after the first part. And we can see that Beowulf is now the king of Geats. And Beowulf actually kills a dragon who attacks his people. Later we can see a dragon comes to attack the people in the land, and Beowulf successfully tried to fight him and kill him. But he successfully killed him, but Beowulf was mortally wounded during that time. So that way it is, and it later ends with Beowulf's mortal burial. So that is regarding the two parts of Beowulf, and that is regarding the plot. So now let's come to the features and analysis of Beowulf. So regarding features and analysis, we need to know that the writing style, it is written in a very brilliant style with a Baroque diction. And Beowulf is set actually in the standard of heroic poetry. So heroism is the main element in that. And the focus is on Beowulf most of the time. And it also, indirectly when we see the work, we can see that it also warns about the transitory nature of worldly glories. So in the story we can see he Beowulf come across too many achievements, and finally we can see his death and he takes nothing with him. So that kind of way the worldly glories, how much it is actually sustained, how much it will last within us. So that kind of idea we can see, and we can also see the use of communal memory and shared tribal history. So they had an oral culture of transferring this epic poem. So there is no written form. We can't see much because they followed an oral tradition. Generations by generations, they will recite the poem, and that way the next generation will acquire the by heart the poem. That way it is. And we can see digressions moving back and forth in time. That kind of plot we can see, flashbacks we can see, that time kind of changing in the time. And a pagan philosophical poem it is, and it is not much different from that of Christian work. So in the last video lecture, we already made a comparison between this heroic poetry and the Christian poetry, because mostly the Anglo-Saxon Germanic tribe people preferred heroic poetry, whereas Christian poetry was preferred by the Celts, who were the early inhabitants who were there when the Anglo-Saxons arrived there. So this belongs to Anglo-Saxon type of culture, Beowulf epic poem. And the character features we can see, many beautiful occasions are there. One such example is the encounter between the young Beowulf and the aged Hrothgar, and it is very beautifully portrayed in the poem. And then we can see Grendel's mother. Grendel's mother is very powerful figure of blood revenge. We can see after the death or the murder of the monster by Beowulf, Grendel's mother also comes to seek revenge of him. So that kind of revengeful kind of attitude, kind of character is Grendel's mother, who is also a monster. And we can see an occasion where the lament of Beowulf is sang by a Geatish woman. So that is also one of the beautiful occasions in the poem. So that's regarding the important features and analysis of the poem. So now let's come to the contemporary significance of this literary epic Beowulf. So we can see how the modern people or the modern writers were influenced by this poem, or how much their attention was actually sought by this literary epic poem, Old English literary epic poem. So actually we need to know that it influenced 20th century writers like W.H. Auden, Geoffrey Hill, Ted Hughes, Seamus Heaney, etc. So we can also see a work called Beowulf, The Monsters and Critics. In 1936, actually it was a lecture by J.R.R. Tolkien, and it held that the main idea was that monsters are also central rather than marginal of the poem's meaning. So when we consider the plot, we need to know that Beowulf was actually killing the monster, his mother also later. So there we can see it as like some marginalized form. When we consider it in a post-structural manner, we can see this the plot, we are depicting it as a as such, if the monsters stand in the margin side and Beowulf is the center, that kind of idea. So when we discuss the theory part, we'll come in detail regarding structuralism and post-structuralism. Now we need to just understand that these monsters are sidelined in the work when we consider the plot. But Tolkien, J.R.R. Tolkien, according to his lecture, he says that it is not like that. So monsters also have their own voice in the poem. They can't be considered as marginal. They are also central to the poem, like that. And we can also see another work produced by Kevin Kernan, and the work is The Electronic Beowulf, written in 1982. And we can see this Kernan's edition is actually a digital reproduction that offers new historical insights into the manuscript. And the manuscript and the text of Beowulf is riven with gaps and mysteries. That means many gaps are there in that where we need to interpret the meaning. So too much kind of ideas, some historical, new historical insights or interpretations were given by Kevin Kernan in Electronic Beowulf, written in 1982. And we can see most of them are aware of this. Beowulf was translated in 1999 by Seamus Heaney, and he recast the poem into a commentary on the history of the relation between Ireland and England. So we need to note that Seamus Heaney translated Beowulf, and this was also asked before in the UGC NET examination too. So that's regarding the contemporary significance of Beowulf. So now I hope that you got an idea regarding the literary epic Beowulf. Now we need to move on to the major writers during the Old English period. First figure is Caedmon. So regarding Caedmon, we need to know that he is a 7th century Northumbrian poet, and he is also called the father of English poetry. But even though he have this name, father of English poetry, we don't know much literary works regarding him. So we need to know that he was a brother at the monastery of Whitby, and there is also an interesting story regarding Caedmon that we need to know. And the details of his life, actually these are known from Venerable Bede's Ecclesiastical History of English Race. So he was actually known to be as an illiterate cowherd. So a miracle happened in his life later, that way it is written in the Ecclesiastical History of English Race. So At a feast that Caedmon attended, everyone was asked to sing a song on a harp. Harp is a musical instrument. So Caedmon actually left the hall ashamed that he could not contribute a song because he is illiterate naturally. And later we can see a man appeared in his dream and said, this line he said, "Sing to me the beginning of all things." So Caedmon was then able to sing verses and words that he had not heard of before. It is said like that. So that's how, through a miracle, he got the ability to recite and sing poems. So according to Bede, this Caedmon founded the school of the Christian poetry called Caedmonian School. And Caedmon's hymn is also very important. So it is an alliterative vernacular verse poem in 9 lines. That is a basic thing regarding Caedmon's hymn. Regarding the details, we will discuss in the Telegram group later. So that is regarding Caedmon. He is a 7th century Northumbrian poet and he is also called the father of Old English poetry. That we need to know. It is very important. Okay, so next we need to move to the writer Cynewulf, who is also an important writer or poet during the Old English period. And regarding the writer, we need to know that he lived in the 9th century. But unlike the regarding the details written about Caedmon in the Ecclesiastical History of English Race, regarding Cynewulf, not much details we are known. So nothing is known for certain about his life, we can say. And he was probably a very religious kind of person and was certainly a Latin scholar. That much we need to know. And in his poetry, we can see the personal note is emphasized, and with him Anglo-Saxon religious poetry moved beyond biblical themes into didactic, devotional and mystical. Didactic means mostly with a moral kind of sense the work was written. So mostly he is connected with Christian themes. His works are connected with Christian themes and Christian ideals regarding the Christianity. So we talked about the Celts, who were fond of Christian kind of elements to be preferred to be imparted in their literary works. So Cynewulf is one such kind of writer, we can say, unlike the epic poem Beowulf, which is a heroic poetry. And regarding the poems of Cynewulf, we can say the Fates of Apostles is there, then Juliana, Elaine, Christ the Second, which is also called the Ascension. Then we can see the School of Cynewulf also. And regarding the theme of Christian elements, the element of cross is predominantly seen in his work, The Dream of the Rood. I have also given a mention during my previous video lecture also, The Dream of the Rood, which is a very important work by Cynewulf. We need to note that. And another work is Andreas, The Phoenix, Judith, etc. So that is regarding the writer Cynewulf. So we have discussed about Caedmon, Cynewulf, and the beginning regarding the epic poem Beowulf too. So that is regarding today's video lecture. So if you have any suggestions for me to take lecture in some other topic, please mention in the comment section below. And also make sure to subscribe to this channel and also press the bell icon so that you will be notified whenever we post a new video. So that's all for today's video lecture. Goodbye and happy learning.